All right. So welcome to all our visitors and regulars. Are there any people from the neighborhood here this morning? Can you raise your hand if you are from the neighborhood? You're in walking distance of the neighborhood. All right. Well, God bless you this morning. Let's give them a hand. This morning's message is entitled Lighting the Way. Can you say Lighting the Way? And if you're new here, you're going to think to yourself, I came to be preached to. Why is he making me preach as well? Because participation is key. We want to make sure that these words that God are giving us today get deep down inside of our hearts so that they can be fruitful. We just came out of a series titled Be Fruitful and Multiply. And now we're talking about lighting the way. Now more than ever, this world is dark. And people are searching for truth. They're searching for answers. They have all this energy on the inside, and they're trying to do something with it, but not all of it is constructive. There's a lot of destruction going on. And we've got to be careful, and we have to understand that everybody's not saved. So if people aren't saved and don't have Jesus living on the inside of them, then they're controlled by the thief. And the Word of God says that the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus is the one that came to give us life. And it's our job as the church to light the way. So today's message is entitled Lighting the Way. Many months ago, Jesus told me that he was going to turn this church inside out. Can you say inside out? Inside out means what used to be on the inside only was now going to be on the outside as well. And he's been doing that so faithfully and so awesomely. You see, it used to be that coming to church was the big event to do, that coming to church had all the power. But now we must understand that it's not just coming to church, it's about being the church and going out and showing people the love of Jesus Christ. You see, the gathering, that's what we are right now. We're gathered, we're the gathering, but we must be filled with gatherers. So each of us have a responsibility to also be a gatherer. So not just to gather in the building, but gather those outside of the building that don't know Jesus Christ as Lord. I want to say something that Dutch Sheets said on June 26th at 5:30 a.m. He posted this. He said this. In the last few years, God has been doing more in the church than through the church, preparing us to be launched out of the furnace and into the earth. The forger's fire has shaped us. Now it's time to boldly ask the Lord to send us into the harvest or send the harvest to us. Can you say amen? Jesus said long ago that the harvest is white. The harvest is plentiful. So just pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send laborers out into the fields to go gather the harvest. And one of the most prevalent things that's going on in this country right now is fear. How many would agree that fear is running rampant? And the only thing that erases fear or drives away fear is love. The Bible says perfect love cast out fear. So as we go out to love the world, it will settle down their fears. My father's passing was about 2 years ago, and I posted something on Facebook, and my sister-in-law Callie, on the first Father's Day without my father, she gave me a book she made. So she would sit here and take notes as my father was pastor, and so she combined all the notes she ever took while he was pastor. And I came upon something my dad said April 20th, 2008. So for those of you who don't know, my father pastored this church for about 4 years before passing it over to me about 5 years ago. And here's what he said in 2008 of April. Jesus isn't going to walk the streets of Lima, but he will be in you so that people will see him in you. That was 2008, and now it's 2020, and that's exactly what this church has started doing. We've started walking the streets to take Jesus to the people, because for so long we've expected people to just come to church. And my father used to say this all the time, it's not a sinner's nature to come to church. We have to go after them, and it's so beautiful to see the people of God beginning to do that now. My basketball coach, Jeff Easton, he posted something on Facebook as I was, you know, reminiscing about my father. And here's what he had to say. Reverend Tibbs did so much for me personally. I think of him every time I look at a lighthouse. That's what people should think of us when they see us. Amen. They should think of us as a lighthouse. That when they see us, they see the light of God. Can you say light of God? Can you say light of God? When they see us, they should see the light of God, and they should think exactly of that, that this is a person that represents Jesus Christ to me. So, about a month ago or so, there was a lady that came over to our house for some counseling from me and my wife. And before she arrived, I began to pray. And I said, Lord, is there a book that I could give her to kind of help her through this situation? As I think about the catalog of books that I have at home. And here's what he said to me. He said, she doesn't need more information. She needs application. She doesn't need more information. She needs application. And just a few weeks later, I found myself in a bookstore walking around. And the last thing I need is another book. And that word hit me again. Dan, you don't need more information. You need application. Say this with me. I don't need more information. I need application. Application is what gets the job done. Application is what pushes the kingdom of God forward. So we can't afford to just be listeners of this word and not doers only. So if you've been coming to this church for a while and your life is still a mess, that just means you're just listening to what God is saying, but you're not putting it into practice. So you don't need more sermons. You need to go and say, Lord, have I done what you've already told me to do? If your life is a mess and in shambles, but you have access to the word of God, what it means is that you've been reading the word or hearing the word, but not applying the word. And the problem is this, when you hear the word or read the word, faith comes. Can you say faith comes? Faith comes into your spirit when you hear the Bible or read the Bible. But faith has a shelf life. Just as if you buy a gallon of milk, there's a date printed on it that says best buy. All right? Your faith has a shelf life. And here's what I mean by that. If you don't use your faith, it will expire on you. How do I know? For the word of God says that faith without works is dead. So everything that you hear, the Bible tells you that you are able to do, if you don't do it, there is a chance that it will not manifest in your life. Because the only way to please God is by faith. Amen? Amen. So, less information, more application. So, COVID came. Have you heard of that? All right. But that came, and it shut some things down. So our Wednesday night service was gone. Okay, we were doing live broadcasts from the studio upstairs. And I began to pray and say, God, I don't want to just rebuild something that used to be just because we used to do that. All right? And he began to remind me of this whole, we don't need more information, we need application. Because listen, do you know what's happening right now while we are in this building listening to the gospel of Jesus Christ? People are dying, going to hell all around us. So we can't afford for this to just be a learning center. There has to be a time where orientation ends. You don't, all of you that have a job, orientation didn't last forever. Maybe just a day or two. But eventually they expect you to start doing the work because faith without works is dead. So it's time for the church to wake up and say, it's not good enough for me to just come sit on a comfortable chair. The things that I am hearing, God is going to require of me to do. Because one day we will stand in front of God and he's going to want to know, well, he's already going to know, if we were a faithful servant, if we did what he said to do. The word of God says, if you love me, then obey my commandments. It did not say this. If you love me, learn my commandments. The learning must transform into doing, man. So Wednesday nights, I said, God, what do you want me to do with Wednesday nights? Because can I be honest? Can I be an honest pastor right now? I was getting bored. Preaching to you twice a week, but really no action. I mean, I love you. I love feeding you, but feeding you doesn't save the world. And then I begin to see all the trouble going on in the land. And I'm saying, God, it's our job. It's not the White House's job to change the world. They don't have the power to change the world. They're powered by the Constitution. They're powered by words of a document only, but we are powered by the Word of God. We are the church, and the church has the power to change the world. We must pray for our president. We must pray for our governors and mayors, but they have very little power. They only have the power that men have given them. Government only has the power that men have given them. But the church, can you say the church? The church has the power that God has given us. So, Wednesday nights. So what are we to do about Wednesday night? When does orientation end? And here's what I see this church as before. It's not that we were in sin before. It's not that we were doing the wrong thing before. But when change comes, and when God says go, do something differently, that's when the sin starts. The sin starts once the new commandment comes to do something else and you don't do it. So here's what this church can't afford to be. This church can't afford to be, let's just use firefighters for example. This church cannot afford to be a training school for firefighters that has hoses and trucks all around and ladders and protective equipment, but yet houses in the neighborhood are burning down around us. But the people inside might say this, but we're just an academy. But we're just a school. But we're still learning. We're still learning how to save lives. We're still learning how to do the job. But you know what? The time has come. Can you say the time has come? The time has come for the church to leave the building and begin putting the fires out. Because we have been empowered by God. Amen? Amen. Let's go to the Word of God. We're going to James chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. James chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen and slow to speak. Lord knows that's not happening in this country right now. Everybody's talking. Everybody has an opinion. But the Word of God says that we should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Is there a lot of anger in the country right now? There is. The Word of God says that we must slow down. Verse 20. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. Church, some of you are angry. And the Bible says that we should be angry and sin not. I know some of you are upset with some of the different organizations that are rising up. I know some of you are upset with the looters and the rioters. But listen, be angry and sin not. Has your anger produced anything? Have you been angry enough to say, Lord, I just pray over them right now that you would give them peace? That's how you know your anger is in the wrong place if it doesn't turn into prayer. If your anger does not produce anything but just messes with you and keeps you upset, then that's an anger that can cause you to fall into sin. Let's go to verse 21. So get rid of all filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the Word of God, the Word God has planted in your hearts, where it has the power to save your souls. Here's the key, listen. But don't just listen to God's Word. You must do what it says, otherwise you are only fooling yourselves. The Holy Spirit is wanting me to share this story with you right now. I believe he'll collect the dots. But anyway, several years ago, I was on my way to church down Northwest Street, and I saw a garbage can in the that fell over into the road. And I got my nice suit on, you know, I got my Sunday best on, and I'm headed into church. And the Lord tells me, he says, listen, I want you to stop and pick up that garbage can. Me? You. I want you to stop, I want you to pull over, and I want you to pick up that garbage can. I stopped, pulled over, picked up the garbage can, and came on to church. Listen, sometimes the things that God tells you to do won't make sense to you. But you do them anyway. Why? Because he said so. It doesn't have to make sense to you at the time. Just be obedient to do what God says for you to do. Why? Because you love him. Love and not religion, okay? So if I would have had a religious mindset, I would say, well, God, I'm on my way to serve your people at the church. And I'm clean, and I might get yuckiness on me. Is yuckiness a word? You know what it meant, right? But I stopped, and I picked up the garbage can, and I kept coming. Do you know what God was doing? Testing my heart. Testing my heart. Do you think you're too good to do the lowest thing I ask you to do? Don't just think it's just about holding the microphone. Will you do the lowest thing I ask you to do? Church, I pose that question to you this morning. Will you do the lowest thing he asks you to do? It's easy to do the things that bring you glory, but will you do the thing that he's asking you to do that you're uncomfortable with? Are you willing to be around people that don't smell like you, don't look like you, don't talk like you? Are you willing to be around those who might curse you out and those that might get yuckiness on you? Because your father told you to. Amen? Let's keep it going. For if you listen to the word and don't obey, it is like glancing at your face in the mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. God blesses us for doing his word. So if you find yourself in a situation of life right now where you feel like you're impoverished and you're not blessed and things just aren't working out for you, I guarantee you, you can tie that back to disobedience somewhere. Did he really say that? I'm never coming back. That's still true. The word of God says, those who are willing and obedient will eat the good of the land. The only way you're going to live a blessed life is to live an obedient life and do what God tells you to do. Let's move on to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. Here, you're going to learn what this church is really all about. The church is not all about coming and singing songs. The church is not all about putting on nice clothes and coming to a building once a week. The church is not even about hearing a message that excites you or energizes you so that you can continue on living and have a little bit more joy. That's not really the true purpose for the church. Let's hear why God made the church and gave gifts to the church. Ephesians 4:11. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors, and the teachers. Their responsibility. Can you say their responsibility? So I have a responsibility as a pastor. And my responsibility is this. To equip God's people to do his work and build up the church. So that's why the church exists, so that you have a place to come to worship and to pray, of course, but ultimately you're being built up to do God's work. So it really is a training center to send you out into the world to build up this world and tell them about Jesus Christ. Church is not about you only. And that's why churches die. Because we get so lazy and think it's all about us. The reason you come to church is not to flush the toilet on last week and start over. The reason you come to church is to be built up in your most holy faith that when you leave this house, that you will walk out into the darkness out there and you will be a lighthouse. Church is not just to make us feel good. We can't walk around feeling good when people are dying and going to hell. Let's keep going. Verse 13. This will continue until we all come into such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. So who is the standard? Christ. That's what you're aiming for. That's why you come to church. You come to church to hear God's word so that your faith will increase, so that the verse that says, as Jesus Christ was in this world, so are we. That's why you come to church. This is the dressing room. This is the academy in which you put on Christ, and then you take Christ to the world, not just your house, but to the world. Amen. We are his disciples, and he is counting on us to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why you are here. You're not here just for you. You're here for the lost. You're here for your neighbor and co-workers and family members that don't know Christ because he is the standard. Amen. Let's go on to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And I want you to know that this verse is going to explain to us that we're all important. There are no big I's and little U's. In 1 Corinthians 12 and 12, the human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. Some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles. Some are slaves, some are free. But we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit. And we all share the same spirit. So no matter if you're white or black or Mexican or Hispanic or Irish, it doesn't matter what you come into Christ because we are one in Christ. Say we are one in Christ. There should be no racism or prejudice that exists in a born-again believer of Jesus Christ at all. Because the Bible says that we are one in Christ. So whatever he is, that's what we are. Amen. Verse 14. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part. If the foot says, I am not part of the body because I am not a hand, does that make it less a part of the body? And if the ear says, I am not part of the body because I am not an eye, would that make it any less part of the body? If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? Or if your whole body were an ear, how would you smell anything? But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. So listen, church, as we move forward, I want you to know that you don't have to have a title in front of your name. You see, this is my whole body, and I use the whole thing. And we are the body of Christ. So it doesn't matter if you have the title of pastor or elder or deacon or missionary. Don't you dare say, because I'm not a deacon or a missionary, that I can't be used. That's a lie. The whole body is used, and not one part of the body is better than the other. We need it all. Okay, so maybe you disagree. So if I went to go get a knife from the kitchen downstairs, came back up. And I asked the question, how many of you are willing to get rid of any of your body parts right now? Come right here and we'll start cutting them off. Not one person would stand in front of me. Why? Because they would realize that my whole body is important. Even the pinky toe is important. Say this with me, church. I am important. Every single one of you is needed to carry out the mission that God has for this church to do. All right? So now we move to Wednesday nights. So what's happening at this church on Wednesday nights now? So Sunday mornings are for revelation. Can you say revelation? And Wednesday nights are for activation. Can you say activation? So what we do on a Sunday is we learn what we're empowered to do through revelation. And here's the sign behind me that says rest right now. We learn through revelation what God has empowered us to do. I'm going to say it again. On Sunday mornings, we learn through revelation, through the Word of God, what we have been empowered to do. Then on Wednesdays, we come back. And God gives us a strategy that leads to triumph. So we have to enter into God's rest. We've got to stop doing things in our own way and say, God, I have the faith to believe that you've got it all figured out. You see, we're kind of working. See, everything has already happened. God knows the end of a thing. But we still got to go through the chapters. We still got to go day by day through each page. But at the very end, as we already know, that God is glorious and triumphant. And one day, a new heaven and a new earth are going to come down from the sky. And there will be no sun anymore because God will be there. And he will be the light. And there will be no more dying and no more sadness. There will only be joy and glory. And there will be none of that garbage anymore. And we will be forever with Jesus. Okay? But we gotta go through every day to get there. All right? But the victory's already out there. But we're just pressing on towards it. But we've got work to do so that others can join us. That's really what it's about. Okay? So, on Wednesday nights, here's what we've started doing. Instead of me just talking to you and continuing to educate you, orientation is over on Wednesday nights, and now we have application. Can you say application? So here's what happens on Wednesday nights now, starting at 6:30. We've got two stations of prayer. On the inside of the church, there are people praying. And on the outside of the church, there are people praying as well. And every single one of them is important. Can you say important? So those that can't walk the neighborhood, they're inside of the church and they're praying for those who are walking and also praying for those outside. Now there's a second prayer station outside, and it's called drive-through prayer. So as people drive down Kibbe Street, they'll see us holding our signs that say drive-through prayer, and they pull into the parking lot to receive prayer. Just last week, a grandmother pulled into the parking lot with her niece, and she said, can you please pray for my niece? She's suicidal. She's got osteoporosis, and she's in so much pain, and she's talking about ending her life. What if we had not been out there? Do you understand that training must end at some time? That class must end at some time? And we must go into the world and be visible? God says that we should be a city that's set up on a hill that cannot be hid. We've got to start caring more about other people than just ourselves. Because that's what Jesus did. Amen? All right. So they're out there and they're praying for people. Also, a mother pulled in. In an SUV with three kids that weren't buckled up. I said, hey, I'm not just a pastor, I'm a police officer, so could you please click it or take it? All right. So she was crying. So a lot of them drove by one time, right, Linda? And they read the signs, and then they would turn around and come back. What does that mean? What does that signal to them? That there's a lighthouse! That there's hope! That I'm depressed and I'm sad and I don't know what to do! And then they see something. And she turned around, and I was able to give them five boxes of food and pray with them. Church, that's what it's all about. If you want to change the world's opinion about church people, then be the church. Because they were right about us. All we do is care about ourselves. All we do is come into the building and get a word and make sure we're okay. But we don't really care much about them. But that's changing now. And the reason it has to change is because Jesus Christ is soon to come. And he needs those who will yell it from the housetops and the streettops and say there is hope in this world. It's not us. We're not the hope of the world. He's the hope of the world. But he lives on the inside of us. Amen? So those two prayer stations every Wednesday night, please come. You don't have to belong to this church to do kingdom work. Do you hear what I'm saying? You don't have to belong to this church to do the work of the kingdom, but please do get the permission of your pastor because I'm not starting church wars. All right? I don't want no drama. All right. So let's go to Matthew 17, 19 through 21. So what I would also ask you guys to start doing on Wednesdays is to fast. Eat your breakfast, okay? But I'm asking that you would either fast lunch or fast dinner. But my true hope is that you would only eat breakfast on Wednesdays and not eat again until after the Wednesday night event is over. Because we need the power of both fasting and prayer, okay? Matthew 17, 19 through 21 says this. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not cast it out? There was a demon and a boy that the disciples couldn't handle. Verse 20. So Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say. I never caught that until just now. Because we just said that faith without works is dead, right? So Jesus says, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say. So faith is not just having it and not doing anything. Faith has to be activated. The seed must be activated. Say this with me, Lord, activate my faith. All right, that's when the blessings of God come once the seed has been activated. Because we know that a seed must go into the ground and die before it produces fruit. So he says, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. And nothing will be impossible for you. However, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. So the reason I need you fasting and praying on Wednesdays while we're here praying and going into the neighborhood is because there's some mountains in this city that need to be moved. There's mountains of drug addiction, mountains of prostitution, mountains of sex trafficking, mountains of anger and bitterness and jealousy. There are mountains out there. They have to be moved. But the word of God says that they will not be moved by prayer only, but some of these only come out by fasting and praying. So I know you're going to drive by QP on the way to church. I know you're going to drive by McDonald's on the way to church. So remember what I told you just a little bit ago? Church isn't just about you. So the more we make church about Jesus again, We'll be able to neglect ourselves and say, you know what, it's not about me, it's about Jesus and pushing his kingdom forward. All right, so while we're talking about fasting, let's listen to the kind of fast that Jesus really wants. And yes, it means not to eat food and to pray, but it means something else as well. Isaiah 58, verses 6 through 11, the Lord talks about the kind of fasting that he wants. Verse 6, This is the kind of fasting I want, church. Free those who are wrongly imprisoned. Light the burden of those who work for you. Let the oppressed go free. And remove the chains that bind people. Remember, I told you just a little while ago that the Spirit of the Lord God is upon us. Just like it says in Isaiah 61. And we've got the power to set the oppressed free and remove the chains that bind people. We've come across so many alcoholics and drug addicts as we walk through the neighborhood. And you know what? The church has the power to set them free. But it's not their nature to come to the church. It's not even the way that God has divinely orchestrated it for them to come to church. Our job is to go to them. Amen. Amen. Amen! Sometimes you gotta amen yourself. Let's keep going. Verse 7. Share your food with the hungry and give shelter to the homeless. Give clothes to those who need them. And do not hide. Say, do not hide. That's what's been happening, church. We come in here on a Sunday and we hide. We come here on a Wednesday and we hide. But the word of God says, do not hide from relatives who need your help. Then your salvation will come like the dawn. And your wounds will quickly heal. Your godliness will lead you forward. And the glory of the Lord will protect you from behind. Then when you call, the Lord will answer. Yes, I am here. He will quickly reply. Remove the heavy yoke of oppression. Stop pointing your finger and spreading vicious rumors. Feed the hungry and help those in trouble. Then your light will shine out from the darkness, and the darkness around you will be as bright as noon. The Lord will guide you continually, giving you water when you are dry, and restoring your strength. You will be like a well-watered garden, like an ever-flowing spring. How does that happen? It happens when we go, when we are obedient to the word of God. Listen to me. I am living the blessed life. God blesses me everywhere I turn. I find blessings just everywhere. As Brother Peter said, he's probably watching online, I'm a blessings collector. But the only way that you can collect blessings, the only way you find blessings all around you is to be obedient to the Lord. Because the Word of God says that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek after Him. So we live the blessed life when we are obedient to God. Amen? All right. James 5:16. Why are we praying on Wednesday nights? Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of the righteous has great power and produces wonderful results. The King James Version says, the effectual fervent prayers of a righteous man avails much. So on Wednesday nights, we got people on the inside praying and people on the outside praying, and these are righteous people, and since they're righteous people, their prayers are being heard in heaven, and God is answering them right away. Why is He answering them right away? Because we just learned in Isaiah that this was the fast that He had chosen, that we would go out and feed the hungry, and that we would be a light to the world, and that's exactly what we are doing. That's why it's so important. So, the final thing we do on a Wednesday night, which is our last station, is that we send teams out into the neighborhood. The first week, only four people went, and we didn't have any wagons, but we praise God for the four. Because here's what God's been teaching me. It's not about the numbers. It's never about the numbers. It's only about the obedience. If you are faithful over a few things, then God will make you ruler over many. So David, will you send them if there's only four? Or will you be so discouraged that you won't do it? When the trash can is not filled on your way to church, will you pick it up? It's just a test. Are you going to do what I told you to do, even if it doesn't make sense? So the first week, we sent out four people, and they walked the neighborhood, and they were able to pray with the folks, and they came back with some testimonies. The second week, 21 people went out, and we had two wagons. The third week, 27 people went out with three wagons. This Wednesday is the fourth week. I don't know how many are going to go, but we got four wagons. We keep multiplying. Because God is blessing us because we're doing what He said to do. And listen, these people, they might be nervous when they leave. I've heard their testimonies. They might be nervous when they leave, but when they come back, I think they probably have to take Tylenol at night because their face hurts so bad from smiling. Because God empowers them, and it just feels so good to be doing it. If you think hearing it is good, you should try doing the Word of God and see the blessing that comes. I'm telling you, church, I don't want you to stand in front of God and say, Him say, depart from me. You worker of iniquity. I never knew you. I want you to hear Him say, well done, thou good and thou faithful servant. Matthew 28. Verses 18 through 20. We've only got two passages and we're out of here. Jesus came and told His disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Eric, you're going to get your list of names ready. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, go. Can you say, go? So it's not just come. Many of us are good at coming to church, but coming is not the great commission. The great commission is going. And listen, I know that everybody's not able to walk the neighborhood, but listen, everybody's not a hand, and everybody's not a foot, but everyone is a part of the body, so we all can do something. So that's why we have some on the inside praying, some on the outside praying, and others walking the neighborhood, and that is the church. The church is not just a building. The church is us. We are the church. We are the carriers of Jesus Christ. I've been in this ministry my whole life. I've seen this church. I've come to this church my whole life almost. And every time I come to this church, it's still standing. It never leaves its corner. It's never walked up and moved across the street. It's always the last place I saw it. May that not be what heaven sees about us. May he not say, the only time I see you is when you go to that building, but you're never the church outside of there. Listen. If the love of God lives on the inside of us, it's time to go. And if you can't go, then it's time to come and it's time to pray. Amen. All right. Eric, if you could come up here, please. Deb, if you could come up here, please. And we're just going to share a few stories, and then we're going to get you out of here. So, Eric, do you want to share your testimony a little bit about what's going on as we go out into the neighborhood? Then you've got a list of names as well.
Well, as we all know, there's a lot going on in this world right now. You see people's faces, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of fear, a lot of lack of hope. And to be able to go out and walk in the street and show people that don't have faith, that don't have this reassurance, God loves them. When we show up, you get a chance, opportunity to pray with them. You see it, you feel it. You see the tears in their eyes when they well up, that somebody's actually concerned and caring about me. And to be able to get out and interface with the people that's out there. We're no different than they were. We're just maybe a little further down the road in our walk with Christ. But it's a walk that we have to do. We've been commanded to do that and to be able to get out there and show the people that we love them. We can't take up and store up what we're learning, like Pastor said, put it in our back pocket and wait till next time. We got to get out there and utilize it, give it away. So the past couple of weeks we've been out about walking the streets, and we've seen some people that there's been a few that we've seen on a regular basis. And just to be able to show love, I mean, we're not shoving Jesus down the throat, not yet. But we're giving him love. We're praying for him. We're letting him know they matter. And just in 2 weeks' time, I would say probably There's probably half a dozen people, and I can't remember their names, but I try to make it a point to remember everybody that I come in contact with. I'm going to go down this list of people. And then Angie talked a couple weeks ago about the ripple effect. You know, one little thing that you can do transcends into so many other people. And when you show love, that you know, even the people that have the hardest heart sees that, and they feel love, and then it goes out into somebody else. So I'm going to read some names off to you, the people that I've prayed for and come in contact with. I'll continue to pray for them, and I know God's going to work in our hearts. We may not see them. We plant the seeds, we may not see the harvest, but we're doing our part. That's all we're asked to do. One girl's name was Rain, Charlotte, Johnny, Steve, Rich, Richard, Anthony, Dave, Heather, Cameron, Jackie, Jamie, Grace, Mary, Raymond, Heidi, Roger, Gary, Josh, Dustin. Like I said, there's about a half dozen more that I can't remember. I can see their faces plain as day, but I can't call their name. That's just in this one spot. Going down. Elizabeth Street, Vine Street, back up Green. That's just one block. We got a whole city. And it, like I said, that ripple effect, it'll just go on out across the... We have a big water, we got a big lake here. It can go forever. So I ask that you would do whatever God's doing in your heart and act. At the very least, pray. But I know he's going to stir your heart and he's call you to action. Shane, you had a big part to do with that. You see the love of him. He's a big man, a big stature of a man. When you see his heart go out to people, and it just warms your heart. You know that God's with you. There's no fear.
Let's give this brother a hand. Now listen to this. Those names you read off from this block of people in the neighborhood, they have not been to the church. But guess what? The church expense of them. And that's the Great Commission. That's doing exactly what Jesus told us to do, amen. She's going to share a very touching story that happened this past week. We don't have to say his name or even the total situation in case some people know him, but God sent her, you know, on the right day at the right time to this individual.
I had went out 2 weeks, and it's awesome. Don't be afraid to go out, you know, and share your story and pray with them. Just be genuine with them. And we had been walking on Wednesday night, and a gentleman walked out of his house, and he was broken because his son had been killed that day 6 years ago. And he was a Christian, but he just couldn't come back to church yet. And he felt like he was suicidal that morning. And I had kind of went through some of the same thing.
I'm sorry. Our son was killed by a relative in an accident, but it was something that could have been prevented. And his was the same way. And as a young child, I tried to commit suicide. It wasn't one of those good attention things. I laid in bed and just wanted to die. And he was thinking about that morning. And I know he's going to come back to church. And we just had a bond, and we just hugged, and I just kept praying for him. And so the other people that were with us. But this is the people that are out there that need help. We've all been in this situation before we were saved, you know. We've all done stuff, and that's not well pleasing to God. But we need to be hands and feet for Christ, for people like this, for the ones that we were before. With bars and everything else, I puke at the bars in London probably. And God chose us to save me too. And so there's nobody that he doesn't love.
So let's be the hands and feet for Christ. Thank you. Can we stand, please? So listen, you've come to church, you've heard the word, and now you're accountable to do what you've heard. Say this with me, God has not given the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind.